This presentation is going to provide a quick overview of the most centrally important measures of central tendency, no pun intended. And a measure of central tendency is any value that is found as to be a typical case or a central case within a data set. And so there are three that are typically examined: the mean, the median, and the mode. And here we're looking specifically at the mean, which is the average. The average is found by taking the total number summed together divided by the number of cases. So if we're looking at ages in a statistics course, we would add those ages together, and if there are 30 students in the class, we would divide by 30, and that would give us our average. And we also make another distinction here, going back to our concerns with inferential statistics, of population versus sample mean. And oftentimes we have to use a sample mean to estimate a population mean because we don't know what the population mean actually is. It's hard to observe all the values from a population. In terms of notation, the letter mu from the Greek alphabet is used to refer to the population mean, while the sample mean is indicated by x bar. Here's another example of the mean, which involves taking the ages of 7 people who are employees of a small company. If you want to know the average age of that company, we just simply add those together, divide by 7, and that gives us 49 years. And if we just kind of look at these values, we can see that, sure, 49 seems to fall sort of in the middle of this range. And the mean age of the employees is 49 years old. The median doesn't involve as much math. It's also less susceptible to being pulled in a direction by an outlier, something we'll talk about in a future time. And it's just the middle value. So if we look at that same range of ages of the 7 employees at the small company, we just go right. First, we have to organize the ages in ascending order, and then we look for the middle value. And since we have an odd number of cases, the middle value is easy to determine. If we don't have an odd number, we have to take the average of the middle two. The mode refers to the most frequent observation. So this gives us a different value here, it turns out, because there are 2 people who are 57. But as we saw, 57 is not the average. That was 49. And the median was the middle value, which was 53. Now the average and the median are much closer to each other than is the mode. It just so happens that there are 2 people of the same age, even though they're not situated in the middle of the distribution. So when we compare the mean, median, and mode, one of the key differences that was mentioned a moment ago is that the mean is vulnerable to outliers. So if we take that same set of data, the same 7 employees, but they hire a new person who's much younger than everybody else, well, because of their young age, that person is what we would call an outlier, right? They're on the outer edge of the distribution. They are not typical, therefore they're not in the middle. And you can see what that does to the mean. It drops it down from the initial 49 to 46.5. The mode is completely unchanged. There's still 2 people who are 57. And the middle value is now, because we have an even number, it has to be the average of the 2 middle ages, and that gives us 48.5, which, as you recall, similar to what it was before, 53, but in this case it was influenced a little bit. But if this were somebody who was 18, you would see the mean really drop down much lower. Sometimes we'll have data that involves different weights applied to different cases, and in this case we have a weighted mean, which is the mean of a data set whose entries do have these varying weights. And a good intuitive example of that, as we see here, is the way that grades are calculated for many courses. And this often stumps my students, I've noticed. They have a hard time grasping this simple equation. So we're going to talk about this equation. So in this example, tests are worth 50% of the grade, homework is worth 30, and the grade, the final is worth 20. So when you add those things together, you have 100% of the grade. And if you didn't apply any weights, then you could simply attach points to this. So test would be worth 500, homework 300, and the final worth 200. And that would be called a point system. But when we have a weighted grade system, that means we're going to give different weights to these categories. Right? So a student receives a total of 80 points on a test. 100 points on homework and 85 points on the final. What is his current grade? We have to come over here and do some calculations where we just simply weight those scores by the grade weight. And there we have the result. Right? So this person has an 87%. In addition to calculating means for individual cases, we can calculate means in a frequency distribution, which is divided by different classes, and we can also we focus on the midpoint. If you recall, we calculated the midpoint as the middle of the range of values in a particular class on the frequency distribution table. So here's an example where we've got our class. This is our old example we were using of the statistics course. You have some students who are 18 to 25, some 26 to 33, and so on. The middle value is the midpoint. And if we wanted to, we could figure out what the midpoint of the mean of the frequency distribution by taking that midpoint value and adjusting it by the frequency by multiplying it. And that summarizing that, we get 909. We take that value, divided by the number of people in the class, which is 30, and we get 30.3. So the mean of the frequency distribution for this class is 30.3. In addition to looking at the central value, the mean, median, or mode, we can also examine the shape of a distribution. We were looking at frequency histograms earlier, and that gives us a visual representation of a distribution. And we would call that distribution symmetric if it forms a nice bell-shaped curve where a line can be drawn through the middle of the graph of the distribution. And each half on the left and right side are a mirror, or at least a close to mirror image of one another. Sometimes a frequency distribution is uniform when there's an equal number of cases within each class. And as we saw with the age distribution data, sometimes we have a skew where there are more cases at a lower or higher level than the middle. So here's an example of something that looks very symmetrical. Kind of has that nice bell-shaped curve. Each half mirrors the other. This one is more skewed. And in this case, we would say that the skew is to the left. That's where the tail is. That's how you can describe the which side is the tail on. That's how you describe the direction of the skew. And here's a right skew. That's where the tail is on the right side of the distribution. And there's the uniform distribution when everything is the same by every class. So you have, sometimes classes are formed based on that idea. Depends on the nature of the data. And here's a comparison of all those different shapes.